our church, Bentry Bible Fellowship, was started in 1976 when a group of families who attended a fellowship Bible church near the Dallas area felt a calling to come and plant a church here in the Carrolton area. So they did. They came and planted a church and they met in a home. And then soon they went to Trinity Christian Academy where we met for several years. And then we eventually got a property on Midway and then here. What was amazing about the early genesis of our church was that the leaders of our church chose carefully the name Bentry Bible Fellowship. Bentry was the local community or the neighborhood around which we were located. So there was a deep value and a desire to be planted in the local community and to share the gospel, the good news of Jesus with neighbors and friends. And we still do that. As Tammy mentioned, pursuing the community, wherever that community is for you, whatever your local neighborhood and community is, whether it's here in Carrolton or regionally or around the country, we want you to pursue people with the good news of Jesus. So Bentry. The last part of our name is fellowship. And that spoke of this biblical, authentic connection we have with one another. Real community. And in those early days, after the worship service, there would be a second service called the sharing service, where people would get up and share needs and what God had done for them. And if there was a certain need that was spoken of, somebody would volunteer to meet that need. And even guests would be identified and someone would take them out to lunch on that day. How amazing is that? We wanted to be connected and known by one another. We are committed to the same today. Right in the middle of our name is the word Bible. Bible, because from the beginning and from now and hopefully forever until Jesus comes back, we're always going to be committed to teaching, applying, loving, reading, taking in, speaking the word of God, which is the Bible. We're committed to seeing God's word as the final authority for our life and appropriate and relevant for daily life and instruction. We want to see our children and students and adults. We want to see singles and married people all walking, loving, and applying the Word of God, the Scriptures, the Holy Bible. Perhaps someone looking from the outside in, they may see our name, and most people won't have an issue with the name Bentry. Yeah, we want to be committed to our local communities. Most people won't have a concern with fellowship. We all want to fellowship and enjoy company with one another. But a lot of people may struggle with the word Bible. They may ask themselves, really, you're committed to the Bible even still? You believe that's the authority of your life? That's the word inspired by God? And our answer is yes, absolutely. I was reading some statistics about last year, 2022, and some of these stats said this, that today, 20% of Americans, only 20% actually believe that the Bible, the Scriptures, is actually the Word of God, to be taken literally word for word. That was a record low. Last year, also, a record high was that 29% of people said that the Bible is an ancient book filled with fables, tales, filled with history and some moral precepts written by men. That was 29% of people. Somewhere in the middle, a large population, 49%, said, well, the overall message of the Bible, the story of the Bible, that might be inspired by God, but all the details, all the stuff in between, that's figurative and symbolic and definitely not literal. So there's this overall theme that's good for us, but everything else, we can pick and choose. It's possible that maybe you have some questions, just like those in our culture. There are more people doubting the Scriptures. Maybe you've got questions like I did once, about, is this really trustworthy? I mean, did King James write the Bible? Was it Constantine who put it all together for his political gain? After all of these years and centuries and decades, how can we trust this book that's gone through many translations and transmission? How do we actually trust the Word of God? Where do we get the Bible from? Now, I would say some doubts that people have may come from legitimate sources, especially those of seeing the Bible misused and misapply, take it out of context. I think about the evil days of slavery in America, 17th and 1800s, where people used the Bible, God's word, to justify the horrible treatment of African slaves in those days. I was even reading this week about the Slave Bible, which in 1800, some missionaries printed a version called the Slave Bible, used to convert and instruct slaves in America. Only problem is, they left out any verses in the Bible that had to do with freedom and equality. And that Bible was shaved by 90% of the Old Testament being removed and 25% of the New Testament being taken out. What a horrible thing. But yet, it was people who were steeped in theology and Bible who championed the abolition movement, who stood for civil rights and women's rights and anyone who restored dignity and value in the society, actually believed in the Bible. They taught, they preached the whole counsel of God, and they believed that we were all image bearers of God. So any act of inequality or injustice was war on image bearers of God. Over the last several thousand years, the Bible has been at the center of so much discussion. It's been disputed, dissected, but yet it's remained the most popular book. Most sold, most smuggled, most translated, most printed, most downloaded. And it's been the center, especially of our Western civilization. So let's talk about some of the questions we may have. Beginning with, where did we get the Bible? Where did we actually get the Bible? Now, I don't want to bust anyone's bubble, but here's the deal. The Bible did not float down from the sky so smoothly. Crisp pages bound in leather with your name imprinted on the front, with maps and footnotes all included, and then coming to your local Lifeway Christian bookstore just for you to come and purchase it. And that's not how we got the scriptures. The Bible is written over 1,600 years through over 40 authors in three different continents and in three different languages. The Old Testament written in Hebrew, the New Testament written in Koine Greek and Aramaic. And then about, you know, if you think about the Old Testament, the 39 books of the Old Testament, they record in broad strokes the story of God and of his people from creation all the way to about 400 BC. And amazingly, beginning in 2nd century BC, the Jewish people began to see the Old Testament documents as authoritative and inspired by God. The New Testament books, the 27 New Testament books, record the story of Jesus, his life, and the church and the prophetic utterances and promises of his return. And it's amazing that these New Testament documents and live witness accounts were written so close to the life of Jesus that live witnesses would have read this, and if anything was wrong or wrongfully recorded, they could refute it or deny it. And then about the 2nd century, people began to acknowledge most of the New Testament books as inspired by God, as authoritative for their life. It began to circulate around the global church. And they saw most of the New Testaments beginning in the 2nd century as authoritative. Then throughout the 2nd century AD, other books began to appear and people claiming that the apostles wrote it. And so the early church fathers and councils had to really meet and vet these other books that claimed to be written by the apostles. So really beginning in 170 AD all the way to 397 AD, different councils and different generations met together and they began to ask these questions of authorship. Was this written by an apostle or someone close to the apostles? Issues of relevance. Is this relevant to the church at large? Questions of inspiration. Can we see the activity of the Holy Spirit inspiring these books? Questions of consistency. Is what we see in these books, is it consistent with the life of Jesus and the teachings of Jesus? And finally, towards the end of 397 AD, the 66 books we have now were concluded to be the authoritative word of God. We call it the canon. And it's not that list that made it authoritative. That list simply recognized that it had already been seen as inspired and authoritative. So that's how we have the 66 books in the Bible that we have today. So if that's how we got the Bible, now the question is, can we trust it? Can we actually trust the Bible? And I want to give us a few evidences because I don't want questions or doubts you have to lead you to either despair or ignorant certainty, but I want it to lead us to reasonable confidence that the book we hold is God's word. First of all, let's look at, now keep your thinking caps on. It's going to feel like a little bit of a class, but you're going to be good students. We're going to go through this. The first evidence I want us to look at is historical evidence, how history proves that the Bible is trustworthy. See, if you're fabricating a story, you're going to make the story as vague as possible. But yet in the scriptures, we have specific places and cities and names that are so specific. You know those sections of the scripture that you kind of read through and so-and-so beget so-and-so and beget so-and-so, kind of glaze over. We ignore that. But all of those specific names are meant for people to go and verify, did these things happen? In fact, if you begin to read the Gospel of Luke, from the very beginning in Luke chapter 1, he mentions all of these specific names and places. In the book of Acts, Luke mentions, Luke, who is a doctor and a historian, He will mention 54 cities, 39 countries, and 9 islands, all of which you can verify, pinpoint on a map. And all of these things and events in the scriptures, you can pinpoint on the timeline of history. It was in the 19th and 20th century that archaeology really took off. We could do with modern technology excavations and dig up ancient cities. When archaeology came on the scene, skeptics and atheists were really excited because they said, hey, all we have to do is prove that some of the cities and the people that are recorded in the Bible, that they don't exist. They never existed. So we can make a case that the Bible isn't true, that it's made up. The only problem is, over the last 2 centuries, every excavation, every attempt to do that has proven the opposite. Every excavation and dig has proven that the stories, the events, the people in the Bible are true as the scriptures recorded it. So many examples, but let me give you one. One of my favorites. We have read in Joshua chapter 6 about the conquest of Jericho. The conquest of Jericho. This is right before the Israelites enter the promised land. They're on the bank of the Jordan River. They see a city called Jericho, and they're supposed to take over that city. So they, for 7 days, march around the city. On the seventh day, on the seventh time, the priests blow their trumpets, and people shouted. And we're told in Joshua 6 that the walls, the perimeter brick walls of that city collapsed out, so that the soldiers could go right into the city. And part of that conquest was to burn the entire city. Now, for a long time, for hundreds of years, skeptics said, look, there is no historical account of a city named Jericho. It's not there. We can't find it. There's no record of it. So this story in the Bible about Joshua and Jericho, that's made up. People dismissed it as false until 1907, when there was excavations done around the bank of the Jordan River. And sure enough, they're digging up all these things, and they ended up digging up an ancient city, and it was named, guess what? Jericho. What's amazing is they dig up the city, and usually when cities are buried, they're brown, but this city was black because it was charred and covered in ashes. They could say, oh, this city was burned. And they began to look at the outside of the city and saw that the brick perimeter wall collapsed outward, just like Joshua 6 recorded. They go inside, and there are these large ancient clay pots filled with burned grain and wheat, because Joshua 6 said that it was a time of the harvest. Now, so they have all these clay pottery. They can now measure the time and the date. So they bring in all these pottery experts. Say, help us identify the year that this took place based on the evidences. And Canaanite pottery experts flew in to study this. They said, hey, this happened in 1400 BC, which is exactly the same time period that the Bible recorded that it happened. A story that was dismissed for centuries. Archaeology said, no, this is true. This is absolutely right. Nelson Glueck, who's an outstanding archaeologist, he said it like this: it may be stated categorically that no archaeological discovery has ever controverted, meaning been contrary, to a biblical reference. Scores of archaeological findings have been made which confirm in clear outline or even in exact detail historical statements in the Bible. And by the same token, proper evaluation of biblical descriptions has often led to amazing discoveries. He's saying, sometimes we've taken clues from the scripture to find out things in history. There's incredible historical evidence for the time, the places, the cities in the scripture. Second of all, we have amazing scientific positions in the Bible. The Bible isn't a science book, but it includes scientific positions. What's amazing about the claims of scripture that has to do with science is that these claims were so contrary to the worldview in which it was written. So these scientific claims are so different, so opposite, so contrary to the worldview in which it was written. For instance, in a time when everybody on the earth believed that the earth was flat. There used to be a time when everybody believed that the earth was flat. Here is what Isaiah 40, verse 22 says. God is enthroned above the sphere of the earth. God is enthroned above the sphere of the earth. This is 2,600 years before we found out The earth isn't flat, but it's round. But God already said it. God is enthroned above the sphere of the earth. In ancient times, when people believed that the earth was held up by something physical, there was no pictures of the galaxy or the universe, no telescope. When people believed that the earth was literally, every religion and worldview believed that the earth was held up by something physical, notice what God said in Job, one of the earliest books of the Bible. Job 26, verse 7. God stretches the northern sky over empty space and hangs the earth on nothing. Wow. Before we could even imagine that this entire earth hangs on nothing, God had already made this statement. If you go through scriptures, especially in the Old Testament, you'll see the cycle of water. You'll see the cycle of precipitation appearing. You'll see how the rivers flow centuries, even hundreds of years before we figured it out on the scientific side. I love how Johannes Kepler, who is a mathematician and astronomer, he said it like this: science is simply thinking God's thoughts after him. Don't you love that? We're just catching up. It's just thinking God set this in motion, and we get to figure out what God was thinking, what he was doing. I was reading the story of Robert Jastrow, who was also an astronomer. He, like most people in his day, did not believe that time, space, and matter — we talked about this a few weeks ago — that the universe, time, space, and matter, he did not believe that it had a beginning point. They thought it had always existed. But the Bible in Genesis begins with time, space, and matter having a beginning. In the beginning, time, God, the first cause, created the heavens, space, and the earth, matter. Time, space, and matter. And then in the 1900s, scientists discovered universally, oh, there is a beginning point to time, space, and matter. And that was now universally accepted. So Robert Jastrow, who once did not believe that, but now believes that, he made this profound statement that I love. He said, "For the scientist who has lived by his faith in the power of reason, the story ends like a bad dream." Here's why. He has scaled the mountains of ignorance. He is about to conquer the highest peak. As he pulls himself over the final rock, he is greeted by a band of theologians. Isn't that good? After we've done all of this work and exploration and we've climbed through the hills of knowledge, we get there finally, and oh, there's the people who have believed this from the beginning. Science often is catching up with what the scripture is saying. The third evidence I want to put before you is manuscript accuracy. Because that's one of the common objections we get. Oh, the Bible has been translated and transmitted, and all these versions have come from thousands of years. Maybe it was accurate in the beginning, but how do we know that this Bible today in the 21st century, that it's still accurate and applicable to us? The Bible was long before the printing press, as you know. It was written on a material called papyrus. Papyrus was the kind of material that would disintegrate every couple of hundred years. So as scripture writers wrote on this parchment or this papyrus, they would, one, memorize the scriptures, and two, as they saw the disintegration of papyrus, they would copy it. They would copy it because they wanted to pass this down to the generations that came after them. But they would do this with extreme care. In fact, people gave their life to being professional scribes who were just devoted to copying the manuscripts of the scripture. They had a long list of rules, and here's what's amazing. They didn't copy word for word. They copied letter for letter. They would get through a page or a part of the parchment. They would count the number of letters, and if it was one more or one less, they would throw that whole thing away and start over because they wanted to be so accurate in copying the scriptures. Now, if you study ancient manuscripts, which I'm sure none of you want to do that, but if you do, you'll realize there's at least two things that build our confidence in ancient manuscripts. Number one, the number of copies that exist. How many copies do we have? Because if you just have a few, you can't really compare and contrast. But if you have a lot, you can compare and contrast if it's true. So the number of copies. Second of all, the time gap, the length of time between the original writing and the first copy we have in hand. So number of copies and the length of time between the original writing and the copies we have in hand. So for comparison, I want to give you a few ancient documents and literature that no one doubts today, that no one is skeptical of. Here they are. First, you have Plato's Tetralogy. It has 7 copies. We have 7 copies. We don't have the original writing, but we have 7 copies of Plato's work. And the time gap is 1,200 years between his original writing and the copy we have. Next, we have Caesar Augustus, and we have 10 copies of his work with 950 years between the original writing and the copy we have. Then we have Aristotle's work with 49 copies, and the time gap is 1,400 years. But nobody doubts Aristotle and his works. Then you have Josephus, who is a prominent historian in the first century. We have 55 of his copies, and the time gap is 800 years. Then you have Homer's Iliad, one of the most famous ancient works that maybe you've read in school. Well, we have the most of any ancient work other than the New Testament. We have 1,757 copies of Homer's Iliad, and the time gap is 400 years. Now, I'm imagining some of you may go home this afternoon and pull up the Homer's Iliad and begin to casually read through it, or Plato's Tetralogy, and no one's going to come up to you and say, how could you believe in that thing? There's only 7 copies of it. The time gap is huge. No one would do that because we all believe it, because we've got confident, reliable copies of it. But yet those are the number of copies we have. In fact, any ancient author, the average of the number of copies is 15 of any influential Greek author. Now, comparing all of that, notice the number of copies we have in the New Testament, of the New Testament. We have 25,000 copies. 6,000 just in the Greek and in many other ancient languages. Total of 25,000. What's remarkable is the time gap. The first gospel we have, the Gospel of Mark, is 50 years. Between the original writing and the copy we hold in our hands, a time gap of 50 years. And if you put the Old Testament and the New Testament together, we have over 66,000 copies of the manuscripts. So all I'm saying is people are doubting the scriptures. We need to throw away Aristotle. We need to throw away Plato. We need to throw away Homer, because we have far more evidence of the Bible documents than we have of any other writing in history. That's what's caused Dan Wallace, who's a great theologian and historian from DTS, who has devoted his life to New Testament manuscripts. He said it like this: if the average size manuscript were 2.5 inches thick, all the copies of the works of an average Greek author, about 15 in average, would stack up to 4 feet high, while the copies of the New Testament would stack up to a mile high. That's the comparison. We have more evidence and manuscripts about Jesus than we do anyone in ancient history, including Julius Caesar and Alexander the Great. More confirmed copies about Jesus and the scripture than we do those people. Now, another objection you might hear is, well, okay, I get the scriptures were written, especially the New Testament in Greek, but it was then translated to Latin. And then from Latin, we think it got translated to German, and then from German to Old English, and then from Old English to Modern English. So it sort of seems like this telephone game, right? Where you whisper a message in a kid's ear, and then they get passed down, and then the end of that line, what you actually hear is so different than the original, because it's been passed on from one kid to the next. Well, if that's how we got the scriptures, I wouldn't trust it either. The only problem is that's not how translations worked. It didn't go from Latin to German and German to English. No. Every Bible translator, they always went to the ancient, most early manuscript. When the Bible is translated, they don't go to the last translation or some intermediary translation. They always go to the earliest copy of God's word. So they would go to the Hebrew manuscript for the Old Testament. And translators would go to the Greek copy, the earliest and best of the New Testament. Why? So that we're not relying on a previous translation. We're relying on the earliest copy. And it secures the accuracy of the scripture. One of the most amazing discoveries about the reliability of the manuscripts of the scriptures happened in 1947. Maybe you've heard of this, the Dead Sea Scrolls. The Dead Sea Scrolls. So what happened was in the Qumran caves, a shepherd boy was there herding his stray animals. So he's there herding his stray animals, and he spies a cave, and he thinks, hey, maybe some of my animals went into that cave to hide from the heat of the day. So he grabs a few rocks and begins to toss rocks into the cave. As he threw a rock into the cave, he heard the shattering of a clay pot. He said, I gotta go check this out. So he went inside to check out what he heard. And lo and behold, there was encased in a vase, in a clay vase, all of these manuscripts, these parchment things rolled up. So he said, this is interesting, what is this? So he takes it to his dad and they get it checked out. Initially, they think it's nothing. But they get it checked out by a papyrus expert. And he tells them, these are copies of the Old Testament. These are ancient copies of the Old Testament. So they send teams back into the same cave and nearby caves. And they begin digging. And they find more fragments and more copies. And soon they have all of the collection of every book of the Old Testament except Esther. They have fragments or collections of every book except Esther. Now, here's why this is significant. Until 1947, the earliest copy of the Old Testament we had was from 900 AD. So here's a timeline from Jesus to 900 AD. This was the earliest manuscripts we had of the Old Testament. But as papyrus experts began to study the dating of these documents, these manuscripts found in the Qumran caves, they realized these manuscripts date back to 100 BC. 100 BC. So students, I got a question for you. How many years are there between 100 BC and 900 AD? Let's see how good you are at your math. How many?
1,000.
Good job. Good job. 1,000 years between 100 BC and 900 AD. So here's what we were able to do. I get so excited. I don't know if you do, but I get so excited. We're able to put on one side the Old Testament manuscripts from 900 AD. And on the other hand, we're able to compare the Old Testament scriptures from 100 BC. And now we can see across a span of 1,000 years, how accurate was this telephone game? How accurate is the translation and the transmission? We can find out exactly what happened in 1,000 years. And here was the discovery. These two copies from 1,000 years apart matched exactly 99.5%. That's amazing. 99.5%. More accuracy than any other ancient text. And those 0.5% of variation dealt with pronunciations and some spelling. Is that a long O or a short O? And the same diligence and accuracy of the Old Testament was used in the New Testament. You might have heard, hey, there's a lot of variances in the New Testament. It's because we got 25,000 copies of it. And 99% of the variations in all of those manuscripts deal with stylistic preferences and names that are spelled a little bit differently. One of the common ones is John, that's spelled sometimes with one N or two N. Whew, that deeply affects my theology, doesn't it? Like if you were to say, hey, my name is Sarah, and I say, hey, is there an H at the end of your name? You said, no. I would have said, liar! You lied to me! No, it's just a preference. And that's what happens with 99% of the variations we may have across 25,000 copies. Now, let me keep going, otherwise we'll be here all day. The next evidence, one of my favorites, is fulfilled prophecy. In the scripture, fulfilled prophecy. No other book contains the kind of prophecies, the accuracy of the prophecies as the Bible. In the Bible, we have 2,500 specific prophecies, of which 2,000 have already been fulfilled. And the remainder of the 500 are either being fulfilled now or will be certainly in the future. The Bible prophesies about the changing of world powers. It prophesies about the rise and fall of emperors and empires, all down to the great accuracy of the smallest of details. The Bible includes over 300 prophecies about the life, birth, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, all of which came true. 800 years before even the form of crucifixion was invented. 800 years before crucifixion was invented, the Bible prophesied that the Messiah would hang on a tree, nailed and pierced through a sword because God was at work. So if a book proves that many prophecies to have come true, this isn't natural, this is supernatural. Another evidence we have is the internal unity of the Bible, the internal unity within the Bible. Let me ask you a question. If you went to a local restaurant, wherever you are, or here in Carrolton, if you just went to a local restaurant and you randomly picked 10 people and you gathered those 10 people in a room. Now, those 10 people would come from the same city. They speak the same language. They probably shared similar culture as you. And you ask those 10 people some question about a controversial topic, like the Cowboys or like some other sport teams. Or religion, or politics. You ask those 10 people who are living in the same time, speaking the same language, even in the same city, you ask them a controversial topic, What are the likelihood of all 10 of those people agreeing with 100% accuracy? Slim to none. He would have all kinds of answers from just 10 people who live in the same city. But yet the Bible is written over 1,600 years through 40 different authors in 3 continents and 3 languages, and all of these authors are telling the same story. You pick any topic and they speak of the same conclusion. There's one theme, not many, one grand story. They speak of the law of God, the love of God, the story of God, the nature of God, the redemptive plan of God. One book to the next, each author points to Jesus and the redemptive plan of God. The Bible is written by prophets and poets, princes and kings, sailors and soldiers, attorneys and doctors, prisoners and common people. It's written inside of caves and homes and ships and palaces and prisons. And yet it tells one story of who God is, his love for the human race, and his redemptive plan for his creation. That in itself is incredibly miraculous, this incredible unity that we have the scriptures amazingly unified. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 21 says it like this: for prophecy never had its origin in the human will, because if it did, there would be all over the place, all kinds of contradictions. But prophecy never had its origin in the human will, but prophets, though human, spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. Imagine an aircraft containing so many individuals with different personalities, all being carried along by an aircraft, leading them to the same destination. The writers of the scripture didn't fall into a trance, and they became unconscious only to wake up, oh, there's a book of the Bible written for me. No. God used the personalities, the individuals, the language, the verbiage, the vocabulary, the life experiences of these people, but they were carried along by the Spirit of God, prompted, filling, God's Spirit filling them up to write the account of who God is and the story of his people. Michael Byrd, a great theologian, he says it like this: the Bible is divinely given and humanly composed, divinely inspired, but yet written through human authors. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16 to 17 says, all scripture, every word, every bit of scripture is inspired by God, literally breathed out by the God of the universe. Why? It's profitable. Therefore, it's profitable for teaching, for rebuking, for correcting, for training in righteousness, so that every man and woman of God may be complete and equipped for every good work. Written through human authors, but inspired by God himself. Here's a bonus one. I wasn't going to include this, but let me put it in here. I think one of the best reasons to trust the scriptures, here it is: Jesus trusted the scriptures. Jesus, who walked on earth, our Lord and Savior, he trusted the scriptures. 78 times in the New Testament, Jesus quotes from 27 different Old Testament books. 78 times from 27 different Old Testament books. If you put together all of the discourse and sayings of Jesus in the New Testament, you'll get about 1,800 verses. And out of those 1,800 verses, 180 of them are Jesus quoting directly from the Old Testament or giving an Old Testament allusion. Nearly a tenth of what he said came right out of the Old Testament. Now, you could accuse Jesus of plagiarism, but he kind of wrote the Old Testament as well, so I guess you can't do that. He trusted in the scriptures. Here's what Mark Middleburg, he wrote a great book called The Questions Christians Hope No One Will Answer. No one will ask. He said this about Jesus in the scripture. He says, extra biblical sources and archaeology tell us the Bible is historically accurate and worth reading. But Jesus tells us that it is spiritually accurate and worth heeding. It's trustworthy enough to read, but it's accurate enough to heed. A few years ago, I was in northern India, and we were broken up into teams of two, and we're in this remote part in northern India, just asking people if we could just pray a blessing over their life. And as we're praying for people, this lady by the name of Asha, she walks up to me and my friend, and she just simply asks with utter desperation, she says, are you men of God? And so we're followers of Jesus. We follow Jesus, who we believe is God. She said, it doesn't matter who you believe, just come and pray for my home. She says, there's so much brokenness in my house. My eldest son has abandoned his wife and kids and left our family. My youngest son is addicted to alcohol and can't get anything right. He is so broken. Other kids of mine and grandkids, they're sick and their life is in danger. Just please come pray for peace. So we begin to walk over a mile and a half on dirt roads, and we get to her small house. And as we get to her house, the youngest son, who was inebriated, he comes and he's so angry that there are some strangers in his house, and I thought he was going to attack us, but we simply said, can we just pray for you before you attack us? Interestingly enough, Stacey was in Dallas, it was like 3 a.m., and God woke her up in the middle of the night to be praying in that moment. So we prayed in the name of Jesus, and when we got done praying, he said, who did you pray to? I said, we prayed to Jesus. He said, my heart that was forever broken is now fixed. Immediately, the peace of God covered him. That opened the door for the gospel. So here's what we did. Oh, clap in just a minute. Let me tell you the rest of the story. Here's what we did. We went through the scripture from creation to Christ. We began to walk through the scripture, about an hour worth of just journeying through the story of God. We get to the gospel, and they're so intrigued. They're asking questions. We get to what Jesus did for them. Now, how he rose from the grave, and at the end, we said, 2,000 years later, this book, this message has come to your doorsteps. What will you do? In unison, they said, we believe, we believe, we believe. They didn't need manuscript accuracy or historical evidence. They just said, we believe. We left the Bible with them, came back the next day, only to find out they had stayed up the whole night reading the New Testament as a family. Entire night. They asked to be baptized because they saw it in the scripture. So we bought a little kiddie pool, filled it up with water, and baptized them. We prayed for the sick. The sick got healed right there on the spot. God restored relationship. The older son came back. The younger son was redeemed. The girls in that family were transformed. And I remember thinking, over the next few days, we planted a first church in that village, in their home, and neighbors were getting saved. And a week in, we're leaving out of that village, and we're walking back the same dirt road we walked in with utter chaos and despair. But this time, this family and a few of their neighbors are singing with joy. They're crying tears of happiness because this book arrived. Jesus was proclaimed through the scriptures. And their lives were transformed. And here's what I want to tell you. Once you've come to trust the scriptures, you must now treasure it. It's not enough to trust it. You must treasure it with your life. Because this book reveals God. It restores hope. It cultivates faith. It inspires our love. It illuminates our path. It promotes freedom. But most of all, we treasure this book because the Bible anticipates Jesus. It reveals Jesus and it explains Jesus. It's all about him. The written word pointing us to the living word. The Bible opens up Jesus and Jesus opens up the Bible. You can't know what the Bible is without Jesus, and you can't know who Jesus is without the Bible. We're so out of time, I'm sorry for that. One of our members gave me this earlier. He said, this is an audio device that's being smuggled right now into closed countries. People literally risking their life because this is filled with the scriptures, the word of God in multiple translations. People treasuring the word of God so much, they're willing to smuggle it in. They treasure it. I was talking to Kevin Run from our family ministry, and he said, you know, the best thing that our adults could do for our students is to actually begin to bring a physical copy of God's word to church with them. And here's why. He said, this device is now the means of so much anxiety and depression and confusion. And sometimes the Bible can get clouded in with everything else on a phone. But he said, if we could be a church that treasured God's word and symbolically said, this word is unique, it's different, it's set apart, we hear the voice of God through the scriptures, that would be symbolically something for our students to say, we don't just treasure it, we trust it and we treasure this book. Encouraging you, maybe on a Sunday, maybe bring your Bible, physical copy, maybe take it to work, let it be a symbolic evidence. We trust and we treasure this book. Here's the last challenge. If you have yet to open the scriptures and read it in some frequency of regularity, I'm asking you, let's be a church that not only trusts, but treasures this word. Let's treasure it in our daily life. Would you do that this week? Let me pray. Father, we thank you for preserving the scriptures, the word of God, inspired by God, given to us for our teaching, our correcting, even our rebuking, but mostly for our life change and transformation. This written word that reveals the living word of Jesus Christ. May we be a church that holds dearly, because in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was God, the Word was with God, and the Word made his dwelling among us. So in the written word, may we encounter over and over Jesus, the source of our life. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much for being here with us. God bless you. Join us for prayer in the prayer room. Any next step we can help you take, we would love to do so. Thank you. Have a great rest of the day.